Hello everyone and welcome to another episode of The Aftermath. My name is Ian, and it is a little dynamic duo again.
Brought to you by the hour on AM.
Yep.
Just what we're currently recording at.
Oh yeah, we never record this at a decent time. Never.
Can't do it.
I mean, you know.
It's tradition at this point.
Of course. It wouldn't feel right if we did it in broad daylight, you know what I mean?
Feel weird.
It's always, just to set the mood, for anybody out there who doesn't know already the podcast, we usually dim the lights, make it all nice and cozy.
Nocturnals only.
Oh, of course, and it's got to be late at night. Usually, sometimes we have hot tea, yeah. Or a nice beverage of some variety.
Mm-hmm.
For any of you out there at home, who's looking to relax,
Oh, God. Put
on The Aftermath. Sit back with your favorite drink.
You might feel something.
Oh, yeah. We might make you laugh.
It's 50-50 at best. You can't expect much.
We'll teach you something.
Maybe.
Or, I don't know, maybe not. I don't know.
So that's if we care enough to rattle off some facts to you, you'll have learned something.
Oh, of course.
Vicariously, perhaps.
Yes. This episode, we're not specifically talking about a movie in particular.
Mm-hmm.
I have been waiting for this moment for a long time.
What do you mean?
I have promised myself that I didn't want to do a Star Wars episode where we watch a Star Wars movie and then we talk about it on the podcast.
Uh-huh.
Because if there's one thing...
It's a fucking bomb.
If there's one niche that I know too much about and it is my wheelhouse and that I love it the most, it is Star Wars. So I feel like if I was to do a podcast where, again, in this format that we do here on The Aftermath... Where we watch the movie and then talk about it afterwards, I feel like I would be.
These are hours.
Yes.
Hours of playtime.
I would not be able to probably contain myself and talk too much about it. And
yeah.
I don't feel like it would be.
Talk about
fair.
A Jabba jaw.
Talk about this guy over here rattling off.
He won't shut the fuck up. I can't stop him.
All he talks about is Star Wars. I think I said this before on the last. Dynamic duo podcast where it was just you and I, where Star Wars and Lord of the Rings are two of those fandoms that I got hooked into and I've just loved very, very much. And it is I love them a lot. But again, just to preface that, great movies.
Oh yeah,
some of them not great. In the Star Wars series again
recently
we won't
talk about those.
Those aren't
real.
In my headcanon, those never happened.
Those are nightmares. That everyone had collectively.
Right. All waking nightmares. All, what is it? Fever dreams. That's what it is. It was all a fever dream.
Some were lucky enough to avoid them.
Right.
I wish I was one of those people.
Ray who?
Do not speak that name here.
Hashtag not my Skywalker.
She literally isn't. She fucking sucks.
Anyways, I don't want to banter about the sequel trilogy because, again, I don't like them a lot. But... I just wanted to reminisce about the good times of Star Wars. Mm-hmm. Everyone can talk so much crap about Star Wars and always has their two cents they want to give.
Right.
But I wanted between you and I to talk about the good things of Star Wars. And to preface this, again, you guys are listening to this on Friday, I think, the 6th or 7th?
Yeah.
If you guys listen to it on the day of. We are recording this on Star Wars Day. So this is Star Wars Day, May the 4th. May the 4th be with you.
Of course.
So, of course, I feel like this is a moment
where...
I had
a couple of people say that to me at work today.
Really?
Yeah.
That's awesome. I love how it's a holiday now. Mm-hmm. It's just an American holiday.
Yeah.
But I don't know if you have any stories, but I know, if nothing else, I have some stories of how...
I wouldn't call them stories so much as just things that I enjoy about the universe.
I have fond memories.
Yeah.
And I think that's why I love it so much. Not only because I think the actual story and everything, like the universe around it, I think is so cool.
Mm-hmm.
But I think it's also, I have very much nostalgic pulls with those movies.
Mm-hmm.
Did you want to start with anything in particular?
My first exposure to Star Wars as a whole was The Phantom Menace on VHS.
Really? That was your first?
Yeah.
Wow.
Started from the quote-unquote start.
Right. Started from the bottom.
Yeah. And I liked it. Thought it was really fucking cool.
Of course.
I mean, at that point, I don't think I had seen anything like it.
How old were you probably at that time?
Oh, gosh.
Prime young boy age.
It was out on VHS.
So probably 8, 7, 8, or maybe 10.
I want to say 6 or 7.
Yeah.
At least.
That's prime age to just watch that fight sequence and know that it was badass. That freaking Darth Maul fight sequence.
Oh, it was cool.
Between the ages of 6 to 10, dude, I'd little boy energy.
In there and I just fast forward to the end
dude,
fight.
All the way to that.
It was so cool.
Dude. Okay, so again, before I tell my story about that moment, I can tell you that I had the trilogy VHS tapes of the original trilogy.
Damn, dude.
And so I had, and this is funny.
Ancient technology.
I don't know why, but I, for some reason, for the longest time, never watched Return of the Jedi.
Really?
I think that I watched it once when I was younger, and I think something about it scared me or whatever.
Was it the Rancor?
I don't know what it was. I don't specifically.
It was pretty scary.
I just remember never fully watching Return of the Jedi and was just kind of always like, I will watch A New Hope and I will watch Empire Strikes Back, but I will not watch Return of the Jedi.
Yeah.
It was a thing in my little boy brain. I don't know why. I don't know what happened.
It had to have been the like first quarter of it with Jabba and all his goons.
Probably so.
There's some freaky shit.
Right. You're right. But regardless, I remember vividly. I wore those tapes out.
Yeah.
It was in like one of those like two part boxes that would like, I always thought it was funny as a kid because if you pushed it on too fast, it was like a like noise, and I was like, it makes like a fart noise.
Oh my god!
Because of course, I was like 6 or 7, you know, obviously. So, but I remember always watching them on our VHS player. It was just me a lot of times. Like I think my mom and my uncle
stupid fart noise. That's so
my mom and my uncle, of course, were like. Were like, they saw them in the movie theater when they first came out back in like the 70s. So they were like OG fans at the time. Right. So I think that's how I became second generation fans of it. But I vividly remember, I don't know how old I was. I want to say I was probably shy of 10 years old.
Yeah.
And I just remember, I don't know why, we had like a pullout couch. And I would always like, have the pull-out couch or, like, sit there, eat snacks or whatever, and, like, watch the VHS movies or whatever.
Yeah.
And so I had, like, this, like, pull-out couch, and I remember looking at Return of the Jedi and going, like, I don't watch that because it's scary. But I was like, but I want to watch it. Mm-hmm. And I was like, I'm going to watch it. And so I remember putting Return of the Jedi in.
Uh-huh.
And then watching it all the way through and getting the whole story.
Yeah.
And I don't know why I didn't watch it ever, but I just remember, and again, my young kid brain, I was like, this is amazing.
What the fuck have I been doing?
Exactly. It's what it felt like for me. I just remember going like, I can't believe that Darth Vader did that. I can't believe that this is this way. And I think at that point, was Return of the Jedi where he says, no, I'm your father?
No, that's
was it
Empire Strikes Back.
Okay, that's what I thought. Okay, so I think I've already seen that before. But I just remember there was like something special that happened in Return of the Jedi that I just remember like all of it made sense. And it was just like finally reading the last chapter of a book or whatever.
Oh, yeah.
And just not fully getting the full story. But I think I got it when I was coherent enough to remember all of it. Mm-hmm. And like I'd seen the other two so many times, I just had them like memorized basically. But man, I just remember being
that final piece of the puzzle.
And I remember just like my mind was blown. I was like, this is the best thing ever.
No one heard from him again.
His parents
walked in on his head, caved in.
And I was
chunks of gray matter all over the damn place.
I was sold ever since, basically.
Your soul, that is.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. my soul is now Star Wars. But I had, and again, with that love carried over into like the prequel trilogy as well.
Oh boy.
So like
see, that's what I grew up with.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I went to the movie theaters to see like the sequel trilogy coming out.
Yeah.
And so seeing that fight in person and remembering all of it and just was like, again, cause I grew up off of like the, you know, the old-fashioned fighting style of, like, the original trilogy. So then to see at the very end, these guys...
It's like pulling off acrobatic shit. There is
four lightsaber blades, and they're flipping and jumping all over the place. And I was like, this is amazing.
This is fucking nuts.
Yes, exactly.
These aren't fencers anymore. They're gymnasts with glow sticks. Yes,
they are freaking amazing. Yeah, and then, of course, I think my love truly blossomed when I was old enough, and then I remember watching Attack of the Clones.
Oh, yeah.
Many people cite that as the weakest Star Wars movie, again, before the sequel trilogy.
Right.
They considered that one, out of the six, they considered the weakest one. They didn't like a lot, but I fell in love with the clones, dude. Mm-hmm. I was like, man, this is amazing.
Easily one of the coolest parts to come out of the entire franchise, I feel like.
Right.
Just the Clone Wars as an era.
Yeah. And then, of course, I forgot how old I was whenever, let me just do some facts while I start talking about this.
Do some facts. Do we have a fax machine?
No, but I will
create one. Are we going to get our facts?
2000.
I've seen one of those things once.
2005 was when, Revenge of the Sith came out.
2005?
2005. So I was, hold on, let me do some math here. I was 11 whenever that movie came out, and I remember.
I was 7.
I remember watching Revenge of the Sith and feeling something emotional, like heavy.
Yeah.
Like, because again, I had watched this character progress, and I knew what was going to happen, I think, already. Mm-hmm. I had preemptively know that he was going to be Darth Vader. I just didn't know how.
Yeah.
And then so to then watch the culmination of all this happening, again, in my childhood being the original the original trilogy, yeah. And then now, like, building up as the new ones are coming out, or, again, at the time, the new ones. Whenever that last one came out, I just remember it was... for the longest time, my favorite Star Wars movie.
Yeah.
Because, again, the effects of it. Again, like I said, it wasn't probably the best movie effects. But, like, again, for a Star Wars movie, it was my favorite. Because, again, I just, something emotional about that fight sequence between Anakin and Obi-Wan sold it for me, dude.
Me and my parents went to see that in the theaters. as soon as Anakin dumbassed his way into being Darth Vader, why not... accounting for the high ground, they tried to cover my eyes while he was getting burned up.
Oh, no.
It's like, wait, what the fuck are you doing? Let me see.
No, come on, please.
Yeah. I want to see this piece of shit get his comeuppance.
Yeah, come on. Come on. But, I just remember that being like a real... I also loved watching the behind the scenes. So I remember having the DVDs of episode 1 and 2. And I loved behind the scenes. I loved the making of. I loved how it was all done.
Oh, yeah.
The actors behind the scenes, because I've always loved that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. And I just remember watching the, like, extended behind the scenes stuff, which I think is like a couple hours worth of material on the DVDs. I just remember watching that on the repeat on all three of them. Just like the blue screen effects, the stunt actions, the goofy outtakes behind the cast. And I lived for it. Mm-hmm. And it made the movie so much better, in my personal opinion. And I'm actually kind of sad that more movies don't have that.
Yeah.
Where you can... Because, again, like that, even though I may not be well-versed in many movies and I may not be a great filmmaker, you know, in the grand scheme of things, that's what I think really sparked a joy for being an actor and being behind the camera and, like, really wanting to make my own movies and, like, do my own stuff with camera work and stuff.
Yeah.
It all started with that. And then there's other movies like that that, again, like other kids' movies I watched that I think had behind-the-scenes stuff. Mm-hmm. And I can't remember them now, but I mean, really was pivotal for me.
I can't remember the last time I saw any, like, behind-the-scenes featurette for anything recent.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it's
limited. Like, watch-alongs, like developer commentaries.
Oh, yeah. I didn't really care for those so much. I sort of did, but
it was interesting.
It never, for me at the time, it never tickled my brain quite like just seeing the behind the scenes stuff. I just was like, I was so impressed with how it all worked. Because again, at that time, it was also like blue screen and again green screen stuff or whatever was kind of all of a new thing or a developing thing. And so for me, I was like, none of that's real. Oh my God. It's like, you know, again, as an 11-year-old, whatever was like mind blown. But, I don't know. I vividly remember sitting on my couch as a young kid and just like watching all the behind the scenes of those original, the prequels over and over again, dude.
It's good stuff.
Oh yeah.
Now, one of the cornerstones for my interest in Star Wars came in the form of a white armor-clad cyborg.
Uh-oh.
That was a supposed to be a ruthless Jedi killer.
Yeah.
And I'm for certain I saw Genndy Tartakovsky's Clone Wars miniseries before the movie came out. And that motherfucker is the only one that has done Grievous right, I feel like.
Really?
Yeah, instead of the coughing fucking mess we got in Revenge of the Sith and the other, like, the CG Clone Wars.
Right, right.
Because, man.
Yeah, you want to talk about a terrifying presence?
It is perfect.
Yeah.
Like, if you show me an imposing and unstoppable character that does cool shit.
Yeah.
I'm going to love him immediately.
Oh, of course. Mm-hmm. Dude, I remember when that series came out on Cartoon Network, and I was amazed by it.
Oh, yeah.
But more specifically, I, again, vividly remember, because, again, I was old enough to remember all this. I had a really close friend of mine, and I went to go see the first movie, the Clone Wars movie.
Yeah.
That they came out with in the movie theaters. I remember watching that and was like, this is amazing. Yep. And then it was a cliffhanger. And I was like, no, there's going to be more movies. And then I remember the debut premiere on Cartoon Network of a series coming out. And I was like, there's no way.
I remember the little in-betweens for commercial breaks. They would have one of the clones saying, we'll be right back with more Star Wars, the Clone Wars.
Oh, man, dude. What a different time. Watching television with advertisements is a primitive thing to me now.
Yeah. I don't do it anymore.
I have YouTube with ad blocker. I can, and again, it's probably, I shouldn't say it out loud, but again, I do. So it's like, I can now freely watch YouTube whenever I want.
The police are gonna come for you, Ian.
Nah. I'm just going to get defunded by YouTube. Yourself. Right, right, right.
Yeah, it was something else. I really enjoyed that show.
Oh, yeah, dude.
I see now that it had a pretty rough start.
Yeah. One thing I can say with all certainty, I want to say it was Dave Filoni who wrote it.
Really?
Yeah, I think Dave Filoni was the one who wrote the whole series. Or directed it, I can't remember.
Mm-hmm.
The introduction of Ahsoka Tano, I was like, dude, this is not going to make any sense because she's not in A New Hope. Mm-hmm. I don't know how they're going to bridge the gap because she's not in Revenge of the Sith. I don't know what's going to happen.
See, what I heard is that most people just hated her.
And again, that was it. For me, I was annoyed because he wrote it as a character.
He wrote
it
purposefully that way.
Yes, exactly. I probably don't love the character as much as some people do, but I loved the character development that she has.
Oh, yeah.
Especially, I watched the episodes.
It was beautiful.
Yes.
I watched an entire fucking video on this. Like, someone did an in-depth analysis of her character progression.
Yeah.
And how she went from one of the most hated characters in the series to one of the most adored.
Of course, yeah. And you want to talk about character development and progression? Watch the whole series.
Oh, yeah.
You'll see some. It's very subtle, and again, not every episode does that, but there are moments where you can really see this person go from a kid to being like an adult in certain capacities.
On Disney Plus, they have a playlist of her like essential episodes.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow, I didn't know that.
Mm-hmm.
That's awesome, dude.
Oh, yeah.
But like, watching that character go through that arc, I think is really cool, and especially up until the part where she gets like kicked out of the Jedi Order. Yeah. There's like that moment of like, wow, that hits heavy.
It sucks.
And again, it's also like I felt in the situation because I've been there. Like not being kicked out of the Jedi Order.
He was kicked out of the Jedi
Yes, of course. I'm not a gray Jedi.
Right.
But is
you're a shit Jedi.
Thanks.
Hey man, I kicked you out for a reason.
I didn't make the rules. Damn it. is you know, belonging to something and then feeling betrayed by it.
Yeah.
By a group of people that you believed in. It's like that kind of stuff is like just that boiled down to that level. It's like I understand that. Yeah. So it's like just feeling that character is like, man, that hits heavy for me. Mm-hmm. But dude.
So yeah.
what a walk down memory lane. Mm-hmm. It's been
speaking of memories.
Uh-oh. Whoa, I don't like that face. Oh, no.
Oh, come on.
I know where you're going.
You knew this was coming.
I just like, he just gave me that like side eye, like,
yeah.
If you listened to the last episode of Dylan and I talking, our little duo cast, we talked about the big O.
Oh, yes.
And at that point, I think I was barely through season one.
Oh, yeah.
But now I have finished.
Didn't have too much.
Finished the whole show.
Oh, yes.
And boy, howdy. What a wild ride that was.
Sure was a show.
It's a roller coaster of emotions at the end. I didn't know what to feel. For those of you who haven't watched it, I fair warning, spoilers. I would definitely recommend watching The Big O.
It's been out for decades. You have no excuse.
It has hit the 20-year mark. I mean, it's your own fault for not watching it.
Fuck you.
I mean, hey, hold on now. I mean, but yeah, you're right though. But it's an anime, and again, just to reiterate it, it's kind of has that noir vibe, kind of a gumshoe detective kind of vibe.
It is Japanese Batman the Animated Series.
Yes.
With mecha.
Yes. But full stop.
That's it.
Big period at the end of that sentence.
Yep.
But I really loved the show. I thought it was really awesome. Mm-hmm. It was just a point for me where, like, at the last two or three episodes, it's like there's a whole lot that happens.
Yeah.
And I feel like I would have loved a season three that kind of expands upon some other stuff and maybe has a little bit more filler to kind of, like, make the show feel longer but then, like, kind of really
flesh out everything that they need to.
Right. Because I that was the only thing I had a complaint about was I just was bombarded by so much. And
still
it was like,
look into that.
Right. I mean, I loved it, though. It was a beautiful, like, technically, like, it was a pretty looking ending. Mm-hmm. It was wonderful. But there was a couple points where I had to stop him and say, like, yeah. Dylan, wait, what now? Hey, excuse me, what happened now?
Personally, I prefer the first season.
Right.
As opposed to the second.
I 100% agree.
Because, goddamn.
What a good...
Not only is there kind of like a jarring animation change between the first and second.
Yeah.
It just, like, the story, I don't know,
It really, so it's like I think I can describe what you're feeling to a certain degree. In the first season, like we talked about last time, we talked about this. It feels like a Monster of the Week vibe.
Yeah,
a new big bad guy of the week, and so it's like it functions like Cowboy Bebop in that same regard. Mm-hmm. That like there is a subtle through line throughout all the episodes of the first season, but there is a fresh start every episode where it's like you're going to start off, there's going to be this arc, this new bad guy going to get their tail whooped, and then, of course, rinse and repeat. But it felt fresh every time because, again, you're, like, again, learning more about this world as it's going on.
Yeah.
Whereas the second season kind of, it loosely follows that. But it focuses more on trying to flush out the story.
Right, it goes hard.
But not only that, but it also still keeps it vague enough that it's hard to kind of follow along with what's wholly going on. Mm-hmm. So it's like, it kind of is like, it tries to do both things at once, but it didn't do either one super, super great.
Yeah.
But it wasn't bad by any means.
Right.
It was just different.
Still enjoyable.
Exactly. So I think
it didn't
ruin
the show for me.
No,
for obvious reasons, I wouldn't have bought the fucking Blu-ray set if I thought it was bad.
Exactly. And again, like the stylistic look of it is, I love it, dude. And then can we talk about the one thing before I knew anything about this show, anything about the robots or Roger Smith himself, Mr. Negotiator, before I knew any of that, Dylan slapped me upside the face with this track called Houston Street. And for those of you out there, I know some people out there who may listen to this podcast don't like saxophones. Don't like, they think they're cheesy. I have friends. Don't,
fuck you.
If you don't like that kind of smooth jazz, again, detective, cop, noir,
you have vibe. No soul.
If you don't like it, I understand. It has its place. Personally, I love it. I think it's amazing. I love that vibe. I love that look. I think it's so cool. Yeah. And that song, Houston Street,
It's never a song that I'm in the mood for, but it will always put me in a mood.
Yes. Right. Correct. There has been so many.
De facto, the song I listen to relax.
Man, and when I tell you the first season, it happens at least once once an episode.
Oh, yeah.
And it is like.
Like the main theme.
Yes. And that is the thing. I thought that was just like a side song in the show.
No.
And then, of course, we boot up episode number one and boom, out the gate, that song's playing. And again, it makes my heart warm and it makes me feel almost sad emotion, but not sad, just like it's a
very melancholic tune.
Yes, and I just love it. And so, again, it just
got
has
a good
that,
fucking soundtrack.
Oh, yes, you're right. The freaking spooky song, I can't remember what the name of that one is, but that kind of spooky song that happens, it's very eerie and weird. But
if you're a good person, you'll listen to this soundtrack.
Just, man, it's so good. I would definitely recommend it. If we can bring it full circle, too. Star Wars.
I should say, if you're not a piece of shit.
Why are you so aggro today?
Not aggro.
Yeah.
I'm spitting the truth.
I mean, I guess you are, but you're definitely you're throwing out some jabs at the people today.
The people that know who they are.
Oh, man. But, again, soundtrack of Star Wars, though.
That's untouchable.
We had this
God tier stuff.
You're right. We had this discussion a couple days ago when you were watching the animated series of Clone Wars.
Yeah.
And I didn't realize this. I think I always subconsciously realized it, but I didn't vocalize it in person until I was sitting there listening to it. And there's all these background sounds in Star Wars. And I thought about it. I was like, the soundscape of Star Wars is so specific. You can have, like, Star Trek or all these other, like, space-based or even, like, futuristic-based movies, and they all kind of have their own sound. But there is something iconic of, like, I can have my eyes closed. I can be in another room, and you can play a scene with no dialogue, and I can pick it out
because
of the sounds of what happens. Ship sounds, alarms, bells and whistles.
You never hear it anywhere else.
Even discrediting like the lightsaber, the iconic sound.
Right.
Everything else around it. I just realized, I was like, as I'm sitting here listening to all these like little things happening in the background, I was like, this is so inherently Star Wars.
Yeah.
And I was like, I love that. I think it's so cool.
It's just as recognizable, regardless of which one it is.
I believe the term is called iconic.
Oh, of course.
Yeah.
Excuse me. Like, one of my favorites, if I had to pick one out, would be the sounds that any of the walkers make.
Right.
Because they all make the same sound.
Right.
At varying pitches. Like an AT-ST or an ATTE.
Yeah.
AT-AT.
Just large, like, kind of clashing metal sounds.
Oh, yeah.
I'm just like, kshing, kshing.
Yeah. Yep. It's beautiful. Yeah.
Dude, I get exactly what you're talking about. Whenever I watched Attack of the Clones, I remember losing my mind over the seismic charge.
Oh my God.
You want to talk about what an epic sound? Oh, man.
It's perfect.
It's hard to describe.
It is the sound of satisfaction.
Yes. Yes.
That's all I can describe it
again,
as.
Again, I don't mean to be weird. I don't mean to be gross. But for me, it's just the sound of, like, a climax. of like this, like you have this, you have commotion,
the buildup.
You have commotion, the buildup,
the
silence,
and
then the sound,
and then the payoff.
Oh man,
it's beautiful.
What a beautiful sound! Mm-hmm. And I, that is this
whoever,
for me.
Whoever made that sound deserves a fucking medal.
I will give you two handshakes and a pat on the back.
Yeah,
man, that was amazing.
Mm-hmm. It's perfect,
dude.
You will be heralded as a hero.
Right. I didn't know this, but I recently found on YouTube they have amazing lightsaber makers.
Oh,
that
yeah.
have amazing like LEDs that are super bright. Mm-hmm. I can't remember all of them. I think there's like, I don't want to say the wrong names, so I'm not going to say any of them because I'm for fear of being incorrect.
No one gets credit on our podcast.
Exactly. But
if you want a name drop, you got to pay for it.
You can easily look it up on YouTube, and I will do this later for you. Mm-hmm. There is a, with these new fancy lightsabers that are all metal construction, super bright, these things called sound fonts that you can preload into the hilt. And, of course, with this new, it's called Smooth Swing, you can...
You showed me this before.
Effortlessly make sound as you move it because of the gyroscopic nature of it or whatever.
Right.
With this sound font, someone... this crafter of these lightsabers went to a sound font maker and was like, I want to commission you to make a sound font. And he's like, okay, what you got? And then in his letter, email, whatever, was like, seismic charge, period. And then the guy's like, don't worry. Or was like, you
got it.
And when I tell you that, you turn the lightsaber on, and a blue light will fly up to the middle, and then, of course, will illuminate from the middle to at the ends, and it goes like the... And the lightsaber... And when I tell you... That's cool in of itself.
Right.
But the deep growl that it makes, and whenever he swings it around, gives me that sensation of, like, this is a powerful weapon.
Yeah.
Even though it's not real. And I'm like, that is terrifying. And I think it's so cool, dude.
Man.
Yeah. And I was like,
that sounds amazing.
But again, those things they're very expensive, though.
Yeah,
but I'm like,
thousands,
I would effortlessly buy one of those just for the clout of having
the
price
of a new car.
I got
for a cool stick that makes a nice sound.
Right. A cool stick that glows and makes a sound. Way to make it.
I could find several of those at Walmart.
Oh, of course, but not like this one.
Oh, no. This one's different.
This one's built different,
even
literally.
Cooler.
Oh, man. So good. Yeah. I remember as a kid having those like plastic ones that are like huge and chunky.
Oh,
and
I hated those.
I felt so cool, dude, as a kid.
Ugh.
Yeah, I mean, I always wanted them to be smaller as a kid. Right. I was like, it's got to be like a real lightsaber.
Feels like it's made for a fucking orc.
Yeah.
Something that's at least three times my size.
Exactly. And now you have kids that are actually like have legitimate ones that are not that expensive.
Lucky bastards.
It's crazy.
I hate them so much.
You ungrateful little turds.
You don't know how good you got it. Back in day,
once upon a time,
when I joined the Corps, we didn't have any fancy smancy tanks. We had sticks, two sticks and a rock for a whole platoon, and we had to share the rock.
What is that from?
That's Sergeant Johnson from Halo 2.
Oh, I see, I see.
That's one of my favorite fucking quotes. From
two sticks and a rock?
Yes.
Wow.
That is what he said to a cowering Marine trying to flee the battlefield.
I love the one.
Gives him a tank.
We've seen this a handful of times where, I can't remember, it's like the bridge sequence, I think, in Halo 2.
Yeah, yeah.
Where he drives up on the tank or whatever, and the guy's like, what does he say? I'm gonna leave now or whatever, or I'm gonna, I just know he says, like, stick close to Master Chief. I don't know what to do.
Stick with the Master Chief. You don't know what to do.
Yeah. I'm
like, gets back in the Pelican, mounts the gun. I know what the lady's like.
Oh, my God. That's actually a really good impression.
He is one of the most magnanimous characters that I have.
Oh, man. What a great character.
Like, he's the fucking cool uncle that you've always wanted.
Right. Yeah. And I think it's also, like, I could just see him at a barbecue just telling stories.
Oh, yeah.
Wacky stories.
Uh-huh.
So good.
Fuck, what else was I got? Oh, speaking of neato universes, one that you're relatively new to is that of Grand Blue Fantasy.
Oh, yeah, dude.
Let's talk a little bit about that, shall we? My first exposure to it was through the recent fighting game made by Arc System Works. And
what a great fighting game, by the way.
It's now, I've heard mixed things about this.
Okay.
This game in particular.
Right, why is that?
It's
not complex enough for them?
You know, that's probably it. I couldn't think of how to word it, but that's honestly why.
I enjoyed it because it isn't that complex.
Right, it's a good like entry-level fighting game to get into, I feel like.
Right.
It's not nearly as complicated as shit like fucking Killer Instinct or...
I remember
or fucking
this,
Skullgirls even.
Really?
Yeah.
I remember playing Injustice, like the first one.
Oh, yeah.
And I remember, like...
Shit was fun.
I remember not being able to do any of the combos correctly.
It took me a while to get Solomon Grundy's entire, like, combo chain put together.
Dude, I just...
I only ever did the main one. I couldn't do the others.
Dude, I just felt like such trash.
Yeah.
Like, it's like there's a point for me where it's a point of... what do you call it? There's like a drop-off point.
Yeah.
Where it's like level of complexity and then like shit's given for me. It's like right. the more it goes up in complexity, the more I'm just like, I'm just going to smash buttons until something happens.
Right.
For me.
That's a pitfall that most people end up going down.
Exactly. And it's not.
And I'm going to be honest, I don't blame you.
Yeah. And so for me,
like the shit they have on these command lists.
Oh my, I remember
nigh impossible sometimes, but man, that's where the satisfaction comes in.
Oh, I mean,
when you're able to pull it off.
And again, I remember
that's why I love fighting games so much.
The first fighting game. I want you to guess what the first fighting game I ever played was.
I want to say Super Smash Brothers Brawl.
Not the first one, but probably the second or third one. To be honest,
yeah, I still count that as a fighting game. A lot of people say it's like a party game.
I consider it a fighting game. I guess, you know, both, you're right. It's a Nintendo game.
If you can have tournaments, it's a fighting game.
Right. There's a fan base.
Although, by that logic, you could call Halo a fighting game. Because there are tournaments for Halo.
Shoot 'em up fighting games?
Yeah. Fighting games, but no fists.
Right. Well, I guess it's like, what would you describe as a fighting game? 2D-ish, 2.5D, punch 'em up. 1v1.
The classic example I would give would be like a 2D fighter, like Street Fighter.
Oh, right, right. Mortal Kombat.
Anything along those lines. Definitely Mortal Kombat.
Right.
But then you got fucking Arena Fighters. I can't.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I mean,
Arena Fighters are finicky.
Yeah.
Can't really get a hold on those.
Yeah. Well, it's also, I mean, like, there's so many subgenres to.
Yeah.
Subgenres.
Right.
Just like music. One person does something different. It's like, I'm creating my own genre of music.
Like, oh, are you?
I see.
All right.
Nice. My 2D fighter is in 3D.
Right.
Oh,
okay.
Nah, yeah.
How original.
I'm kidding.
Remove the fucking.
I'm joking. I have no clout to make this much, like, to make this much hatred. Like, I'm sorry for anybody who actually cares out there. Yeah. I'm just kidding, please.
Oh, man.
But the first fighter game I ever played was Tekken Tag.
Are you fucking serious?
Nope.
Tekken Tag.
Oh, my dude. God. Yeah. And I remember the same sort of thing. That was just complex enough combos.
You know I have Tekken 7, right?
Really?
Yeah.
I haven't played any of the newer ones.
Oh, man.
Dude. So I remember playing as a handful of characters. Mm-hmm. And like I said, I just remember the combos being complex enough that were hard.
Yeah.
But easy enough that I could like pull them off, right. And I was like, dude, I feel so cool.
Uh-huh. It's one of the best feelings I could think of.
Right.
Just
it was on the PS2.
Like, especially just like stringing together something long.
Yeah, yeah. Really laying into somebody.
Putting together a TOD.
Yeah. I always felt good whenever you like a perfect finish.
Mm-hmm.
Not even a scratch on you. It's like, dude, I'm unbeatable.
Nothing could fucking stop me.
Until you get to that one hard character and then you're the opposite. You can't hit on him and you're like, I am trash at this game.
Now, for context, that for us right now, that character that we've...
Oh, God, please, no.
Is Zoe.
Okay, in our
defense... The Arbiter of Fate.
In our defense...
And boy, you'd fucking be able to tell...
in our defense, it is like the hard mode in boss version.
Is it though?
I mean,
we've seen hard mode. It still starts at the beginning. Like this bullshit they're hitting us with is just fucking raw.
I guess you're right, but I'm thinking it's also, what is it, her name? Grand Order.
Yeah, that's the title they give her for this fucking boss.
For those
fight.
Of you who may or may not know, it is episode 40 and a half. Mm-hmm. And I can't remember the name of it, but it is her like almost final form or whatever. And dude,
first player has to be Belial.
Yes.
No one else.
Right.
If you have a co-op partner, which I would highly recommend, you probably couldn't pull it off. Why
wouldn't you?
You're a fucking god.
Oh man.
But Ian's been rocking Percival.
I've been doing great.
Lord of Flames.
I've been doing an awesome job.
I think a good job. You've really gotten a grip on it.
I mean, especially from my limited knowledge of fighting games.
Yeah, you picked it up quick.
I'm like I said, I still haven't quite gotten how some of the combos work out, but that's just, I think, a practice thing for me.
Yeah, but you need to go into like free training and just learn some of this stuff.
Of course. But there is a point where, again, and I think I'm loving this so much because it is giving me MMO vibes.
Oh, yeah?
Yes. I love MMO games. For those of you who know me, I play numerous games. And again, for bringing it full circle, I love Star Wars The Old Republic.
Right.
And I am unabashedly unashamed to say that.
Thrice upon a time, there was a man named Ian. He liked Star Wars. Did you know that?
Yes.
Bet you might not have caught it the first two times.
Right.
Just so you know, third time's the charm.
Just in case you had any doubts, I'm solidifying it right now.
Here you go, son.
Yes.
Go see a Star War.
Go see a Star War. But I've played many MMO games. Not probably the conventionally most popular ones, but I've played Lord of the Rings Online, Star Wars The Old Republic. Yeah. I have played, I would consider PlanetSide 2 another one. I've played many of them, and I love that. But the conventional thing is I love group content where you have a run or an instance or a skirmish or whatever you want to call it, where you have this like enemy or this sequence of events, and there is a planned like methodical action to it.
Yeah,
where it's like you
it's all trial
a strategy,
and error.
Strategy.
In our case, error and error,
error and potential victory.
Yes,
but,
almost.
Hold on! Don't get there. I'm not getting there.
Okay, it's okay. That shit just hit me. Okay.
I know. Okay. I love that. I love that kind of that, the finding out the strategy, finding out what works, finding
it's
out
fun.
What doesn't, and I love that. And I love that about group content in MMOs specifically, and that gave me that vibe so much of like hitting a boss and then learning out new stuff, and then of course there's most big bosses, especially those final bosses, always have that insta kill mechanic. And
oh yeah,
ooh boy howdy,
rage, or in our case overdrive.
Oh boy howdy, did we find like you're not even probably in like you're in like the second phase of the game. For the boss fight,
right.
And she just has like an insta kill mechanic, and I for the life of me couldn't figure out how to freaking figure it out.
Oh yeah,
I googled it and was like, oh, you just crouch in a corner. I was like, ah, I see. It doesn't seem like you should be able to do that.
Yeah,
I will let Dylan tell you what happened whenever we got to the furthest point that we had ever gotten before.
All right, so
sorry,
this is.
It's still a little hurt. It still hurts from, sorry, I don't want to.
It's. I think it was at least our fourth or fifth attempt.
Right.
If that's any indication as to how hard this fucking bitch was.
Right.
So, the first phase is her shifting around, calling down lightning bolts. You just got to get up in her face.
Right,
guard
right.
at certain points.
Yeah.
Pull off
pretty
supers
bog standard.
Whenever you can. The supers are really crucial. Like, they do the most amount of damage.
Right, of course.
We've got all the abilities we need to help us out. I've got a debuff that cuts their attack and defense down.
I got some heals.
Yeah, we both got heals.
Yeah, eventually.
No way we're going down with that shit.
Right.
But once she gets to the second phase, her first overdrive, she brings out a fucking dragon.
Yeah.
I'd only ever seen it like used as her super skybound art. Where she calls this thing down, gets onto it, she ends up looking like a freaking dragon centaur.
Yes. Some kind of amalgamation.
Obliterates everything. So, once we get the dragon down a few times,
she's invulnerable during the second phase. Like, she'll just be up in the air calling down lightning while her dragon is doing all the nitty-gritty.
Right.
So we have to take it out first, then she'll come down and, like, pet it for a bit and be like, it's okay.
Right,
like,
right.
It's only the second time they've kicked your ass. You'll be all right.
You'll be fine, yeah.
And then around, like, the third or fourth time that we take it down, she gets in it and becomes the dragon centaur.
Right.
And starts off with this fucking map, like, stage-wide ability that takes both of our health down to one.
Yeah. Well, she like charges it up, mm-hmm. and then whenever she finishes the charge, like the channeled ability,
oh, yeah.
when she finishes it, it bam, it will no matter what level, no matter how much health he has, mm-hmm. it always brings you down to one health.
You got nothing.
It's left. It's that scramble ability where you're like, oh my god, uh-huh. some healer, please.
Yeah,
yeah.
So,
again, to preface,
we both had heals round, at our disposal. Like, we worked that out after God knows how many failures.
Yes, we're probably on. Attempt number five.
Yeah.
Possibly.
Right. So we keep doing damage to her. Her moveset while she's in this thing is ridiculous. It's like she takes up center stage.
Yeah.
And
swings.
Like there's almost nowhere safe. Some moves you got to jump or just low block for. Otherwise, you just have to like fucking avoid altogether. They're unblockable.
Yeah. Yeah.
But she'll do that same charging attack again.
Yeah.
Now, we didn't know this at first, but if you attack her and do enough damage, it will put her into break mode.
Yeah.
Which is when we need to utilize our supers to do, like, a shit ton more damage than we're normally able to.
Yeah, yeah.
And we had this bitch on the ropes.
We had
160 seconds to go.
And not only that, we also had her down.
Less than a quarter of health left.
The furthest we had ever gotten. Mm-hmm. I could see the light in the tunnel.
Victory was within our grasp.
We had, like I said, we at this point in time, we had only ever gotten her down to like 40-something, 30-something. We had her down to the 25 mark.
Oh, yeah. She was done for. We had already won.
But so we thought.
The PlayStation thought otherwise. You see, it also is an arbiter of fate.
Oh, yeah. It also
and
decided
it
to put
us in our place.
It decided to put us in our place.
The hubris. That we surely had on our shoulders that night was unbearable. And the world said, nay.
Yeah.
Get fucked.
That bitch crashed.
So my PS4 crashed.
Oh, man. Whole game, error code, everything.
Oh,
and
yeah.
I mean, but like the funniest part was, is that like, we were like, again, as you can imagine on a boss fight, once you're this down to the wire, I started to get frantic. I started to move around a lot. Yeah. I started to get antsy.
You get in the zone.
My heart's racing. You know, we're
you're firing adrenaline left and right.
Yeah, you know, I'm doing combos. And then, of course, the screen pauses.
Yeah.
And then, of course, my first reaction is, oh, shit, it's going to crash. And then, lo and behold, we got the message. And the only thing that I can do was just start laughing. I laughed so hard I started to cry. And I'm not sure if those were cries of happiness or of sadness.
I was so pissed. I couldn't even fucking look at the screen.
Oh, man, I was like, ugh. And then after I settled down, I was like,
I really wanted to give up after that.
After I sat down for a second, I was like, that took a lot out of me.
Yeah.
I'm like, oh, man, I don't know if
I could. It was so fucking good. It was the best run we had so far.
It's great. But nay.
No, we can't have that.
Not that night.
God forbid we succeed at something.
But yeah, I've been enjoying playing the game. I thought it's been a lot of fun. Again, to kind of bring it back around to our initial statement like we were talking about, Tekken Tag was my first fighting game with that kind of like 2D fighting element, but like the arena kind of rotated a little bit with how. So like, I thought it was really interesting. Mm-hmm.
It reminds me of Virtua Fighter.
Almost. Right.
How it's not like fully 3D, but actually, no. Yeah, it was fully 3D.
Yeah.
For its time. That's like one of the earliest 3D fighters I know of.
Yeah.
Back on the Sega Saturn.
Oh, wow.
Oh, man.
I played... Probably Brawl was, like, my next one.
Man.
Like, realistically thinking about it.
My sisters romped Super Smash Brothers growing up.
Yeah.
We've been through that entire series.
And the next one for me was probably Soul Calibur.
Yeah. Oh, God, I love Soul Calibur so much.
I've never actually probably played, like... I never played a lot of Street Fighter or of Mortal Kombat, like the two pillars of fighting games.
I've been very tempted
to open up that factory sealed copy of Soul Calibur 2.
Oh.
I really don't want to. I don't have any other copies of Soul Calibur 2, though.
Right.
I'm going to get the one for the GameCube.
Yeah.
That way we can play as Link.
You could do that?
Oh, yeah. Dude, they had, like, exclusive characters
for each
different version. Like, yeah, for Soul, Xbox, they had Spawn.
I was like, don't even start with me. Soul Calibur 5 was when I played, and you can play as Yoda, Darth Vader, and Starkiller. And I was like, you kidding me?
Darth Vader's so much fun in that game.
Again, bringing it full circle, Star Wars episode.
Fourth.
Wee-woo.
Number four. Give it up, ladies and gentlemen.
For the 4th of May.
The quadruple.
Speaking of this, I wanted to do a little... Speaking of our announcer voice.
Oh, boy.
I know we're already at the 50-minute mark, and I just want to tangent.
We're at 50 minutes.
Yes, exactly.
Oh, God.
Oh, dude, anytime you and I ever talk, we have long episodes.
We do.
I hope you guys enjoy this. I really do.
If you don't, I mean, nothing's keeping you here.
I heard a certain type of song, and partially, I already had the, what would you say? I had, like, the inspiration from our last episode. For those of you who heard the last, we started tangenting about...
Freedom Brew.
you ever drink a beer? And I laughed so hard at it.
That was so good.
That I started talking to someone about, like, how wacky, like, the 50s and the 60s were.
Oh, jeez.
Or, like, even, like, 40s, 50s, and 60s, where it was, like, the American dream... People were just like, they loved the America just for like that kind of post-Cold.
Who's it's and American whatnots.
Yeah, the post-Cold War kind of like, America's a great place and, you know, screw communism. And I loved that. And then I heard a song, like I heard like this kind of like, let me just play this for a second.
Reminds me of Fallout.
Yes. I heard this kind of like jingle, like commercial sound song, and I want to say this is royalty free, so I'm hoping I'm okay, and I hope this doesn't get flagged. We'll know soon enough. And the only thing I can think,
I mean, it's too late now. If it is, you screwed us.
I know. I mean, it was like what, four seconds, but I heard this, and all I could think about was like just random idea, like random stupid ideas of gadgets. Like, welcome to something, you know, whatever. That's all I could think about. Yeah. And I just started getting a kick out of it where I was thinking about the same thing as like...
It's always something you see portrayed, but I've never looked up like an old commercial from the 50s.
Right.
To see if it's actually got music like that in there.
Yeah.
It's like presenting the new microwave oven.
Yeah.
So easy, even your husband could use it.
Oh.
That was fucking
stupid. Ever want to put a whole ham inside of a microwave?
Well, worry no more. We've got the gadget for you.
The turbo diddly will get your ham.
I'm sorry, Dave. The what?
You heard me right.
The turbo diddly. Now, is this the Mark IV or is it, is it the Mark VI?
Oh, man. It'll cook a whole ham.
By Joe, a whole ham, Dave.
A whole ham.
The fuck are you going to do with a whole ham?
I'm going to put it in my turbo diddly right quick.
What do you think I got the fucking turbo diddly for?
You ever want...
It's only for hams.
You ever seen a microwave oven with a rocket on it?
Well, now we're just going to give you the whole damn rocket.
With our new turbo diddly.
That's right, ladies and gentlemen, your very own rocket.
It's a nuclear-powered microwave oven.
If you can find the microwave in there, you get to keep it.
Is it like...
You've already owned the rocket.
Oh, man, it's so good.
But if you consider yourself a savvy enough engineer,
right. You
shouldn't be too worried.
Oh, man, it's so
really
great.
Put a whole fucking microwave in there. I can't believe I'm selling this shit.
I can't believe I'm doing this, Joe. Jolly Cola, the best drink in the world.
Jolly Cola, is that real? Is that like...
No, no,
I'm
making it up.
Just spitball.
Yeah. Has actual heroin in it.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
Dave, what are you doing? No. Cut the music. Cut the fucking music. This isn't funny anymore. Actual heroin?
Yeah, Jolly Cola.
I said cut the music. What are you doing?
Oh, man, it's so great.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm sorry.
Oh, man.
This is not an actual product. If you see this anywhere, do not buy it.
Right.
Oh, my God.
Do you ever want more from your cola?
Dave!
Charlie Cola. Get into today at your local supermarket. I'm calling the police, Dave. Sorry.
Oh, man.
Oh, it's so great. I love it.
Something unsettling about a song that happy-go-lucky.
Right.
I honestly don't like it.
Yeah?
Yeah, it freaks me out a bit. It reminds me of that particular part in time, like where
life was kind of...
Well, again, I've never looked anything up with that kind of music in it.
Really?
It's only ever something that...
It's usually always seen. Like hyper jolly, like yeah. Kind of that kind of stuff.
Like,
come
sure
on, Billy, let's go down to the creek.
Yeah, I'm sure they wouldn't make it a trope if it wasn't pretty prominent. Back
I mean,
then,
that probably
like
is
advertising.
Like it's probably like less than like tropey, but I mean, it probably still fits the same mold.
Well, you see, now I'm curious. Now I got to do a deep dive into this.
Of course,
bullshit.
I just again, I thought I heard this kind of song, and I just started thinking of dumb stuff. I can't think of anything that I said that I was thinking about, but you know.
Turbo diddly.
I don't even know where that came from. That sounds so dumb now.
I want to make it real.
Oh, yeah.
It's got to be real.
Inventions for the 21st century. For the 21st century. 20th century, sorry.
21st century.
Oh, my bad.
No, I'm not. I'm just thinking about the term 21st century.
I just see
I see a optimistic about that.
I see a factory.
A factory.
A factory like making canned soup.
Wow.
Yeah.
Campbell's was all the rage.
It was.
Back in the olds.
The olds.
Anyway. Sorry. if we could get back to
you ever here. Wanted to put water in the freezer to freeze it?
Do you know what an ice cube is, ladies and gentlemen?
Yeah. The new turbo ice tray.
Turbo ice tray. Yeah. Are we turbo industries? Everything has to have turbo.
Turbo.
As a prefix.
Right. The new turbo car.
In fact.
A nuclear reactor inside the engine. Never need gasoline or petrol again.
Ladies and gentlemen, we love the turbo brand so much, we decided to double down.
And our
introducing the new Turbo.
Can our mascot be Turbo Timmy?
Turbo Timmy.
And he's just like a guy going like, yeah. Welcome Turbo to Turbo Timmy. Industries, where we are a brand for you.
Where we.
Pine Grove. I was going to say, it's royalty free thing. So it's like, nee, 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 in the background.
Oh, it's got I see. Okay, that's why.
Yes.
Man.
I love it. Once upon a time, I had the idea to create a thing, and thus Turbo Industries.
That's amazing, Dave. Again, I needn't remind you of the restraining order I now have placed over you.
Why is that?
Because of your fucking heroin soda.
I was kidding. It's LSD.
LSD! Dave!
Dave!
All right, Dave, you've had your fun. Get the fuck out.
Turbo television.
Dave, I swear to God.
Man, there is so many channels, you don't know what to do with it.
I know what to do, Dave.
Have you ever wanted a microwave inside of your television?
Dave, I'm going to kill you.
I have the means.
I got to kill you, Dave.
You ever want to put a ham inside of a TV?
I'm about to put you in the TV, Dave.
Do it.
Oh,
I could fit in that whole damn television.
You wouldn't fucking dare. I made this company from the ground up.
Oh, man. I just love him going like, you don't want to put it in a microwave inside of a television? Anyways, we're approaching the hour mark, guys. I just thought it'd be fun.
Okay. Anyway.
The name is Turbo Timmy.
David, I swear, on my mother's grave. Something's got to give here, man.
I'm sorry.
It's all right. It's okay. It's going to be okay once I don't have to see you anymore.
Right.
All right. Now, what I was going to ask you.
Sorry.
What's your favorite character from Grand Blue?
So far, I've liked Lance a lot and I like Percival a lot. Those two guys are like my go-tos. Oh, come on.
Oh, no. It's not that. Keep going. Just tell me.
Yeah.
Explain to me.
I just like their armor. I think, like I said, one of them moves fast, one of them like hits heavy, so I love like the kind of combination of the two.
You haven't looked into their backstories yet.
I have not.
Oh, fuck.
I think it'd actually be really cool.
Shit.
But there is some other other character, like the design of, but I haven't actually played any of. Yeah. So, but I didn't realize there was so much of a like a backstory behind it. And
oh yeah,
I think it's really cool that
they have so much clout for these motherfuckers, for this like almost too much for this to be based off of a fucking gacha game.
That's crazy.
It's insane to me.
Yeah.
Like, well, there's not a single character in this game so far that I don't like.
Yeah. I did some light research about it, and you're right. There's so many characters.
Oh, yeah. Metric fuck ton.
Friends of pals of buddies of other guys. I'm like, oh, geez. Mm-hmm. It's expansive.
Yeah.
But anyways, we're at the hour mark. Thank you so much, everyone, for listening. I really appreciate it, especially on this episode. May the fourth be with you. It's amazing. Ooh, I love Star Wars, if you couldn't tell. Thank
Fifth
you for
time now.
Thank
Number
you
five.
For yeah.
Cinco de Mayo.
Oh, Revenge of the Fifth.
Mm-hmm.
So
forgot about that one. That was funny.
We have a Linktree / Ian Wolf. Has all of our links, social media links, all that stuff there. You can go on
if you dare.
aftermath.buzzsprout.com. It's our website that we have. Where you can get all the links there as well, or all the episodes just right there on the page. You can do whatever you want there. Again, really appreciate you listening. This has been a wild ride. Thanks for joining us, even though I went on that little tangent there. I thank you for humoring me, because I had to get that off my chest. I thought it'd be so funny.
Oh,
so
man.
If Turbo Tommy or Timmy, I like Tommy.
Yeah,
Turbo Tommy. If Turbo Tommy makes an appearance, just
bomb me.
Just know that he. He doesn't belong here. None of us like him, but you know.
No, he is a wretch created by the great greed of market.
I don't like him, but I mean, he always likes to rear his ugly head. So, anyways, until next time, thank you and
yeah, bye.
Bye bye.